Hello and welcome to the Fighting Spirit Podcast. As always, I'm Jason and I'm here to bring you your retrospective on UFC 239, where John Jones squeaked out a victory against Thiago Santos. On this night, we went 8-4, so 67% accuracy. We're back to our high accuracy ways, and I'm looking forward to keeping those going. Anyways, let's talk about the night of fights. Here's the show. All right, so in our main event, this is our first victory on the night. We got this one correct, but only just so. So this John Jones-Thiago Santos fight, this was a close one. This was a nail-biter. This is one that I did not feel comfortable in at any point in time, except maybe after Thiago hurts his knee. So this fight is very close. I said in my podcast before, this is really the first time John Jones has gone against a murderous puncher since maybe Glover Teixeira. And Thiago Santos, I think, trumps Glover Teixeira's, you know, punching power. You know, if we had maybe seen the Rumble Johnson-Jones fight, if that had come to fruition, we would have seen him face a murderous puncher like somebody like Santos, but that didn't happen, so this is really the first real test of Jones, and he played it intelligent. Any mistake he knew could have cost him everything, and so he played a very rangy outside game that really just depended on leg kicks, kicks to the obliques, kicks to the solar plexus, and just a lot of really smart strikes only when necessary. John Jones did ultimately outstrike Thiago Santos 59-43, but anytime we looked at damage, it seemed like Thiago was doing slightly more. So going into, I think, what was the second round, it looked like Thiago was coming out fast and hot, and we thought that maybe Jones's idea was to burn him out. But I think Jones was just playing so cautiously that he ended up catching a real lucky break when Thiago basically tears his ACL or something in his knee and ends up being compromised throughout this fight. You know, he was still throwing hard, he was still moving well, but you could see at times his leg was buckling out. Jones was kicking him in the knee to try to, you know, exacerbate that condition. Didn't really seem to faze Thiago, but we'll never really know what could have been had his knee stayed healthy, if he wasn't injured during the fight. I think that Santos could have ultimately taken this one. It was a split decision, even with three full rounds of an injured Thiago Santos. Jones was just able to squeak past here and pick up a W. So, like I said, I was scared. We did ultimately get it correct, though. That's all that really matters. And hey, hats off to John Jones to continuing to be that light heavyweight, or maybe all-time MMA GOAT. All right, moving on to our co-main. We had Amanda Nunes defeating Holly Holm in what was kind of a tough bout for me to watch. You know, I actually, you know, my number is also Nunes, and I picked Nunes, and I would tell you guys that all day. However, in my heart of hearts, deep in my gut, I thought Holm was going to get the upset here. It's kind of why I called her the giant killer in the podcast. I thought that she might have had the tools to derail Nunes. That just was not the case, though. So in about 4 minutes in, Nunes lands this great head kick, kind of a payback, I guess, in a lot of ways for what we saw what Holm did to Ronda Rousey. And Nunes got it done, KOing Holly Holm late into that first round. And Holly looked okay. You know, she looked like she was playing her game pretty well. She didn't really inflict any real damage on Nunes. She kind of wobbled her a little bit, stunned her maybe for a moment, but I don't think in the grand scheme of things it really meant anything. Nunes kind of shook it off right away. She put the pressure on and connects with that great head kick, earning herself performance of the night money. And hey, hats off to Amanda Nunes, maybe the lady goat. For sure, I don't know anybody else that she would have to face at this point that could defeat her. The only one I can think of, and you could argue that she actually defeated her in her first fight against her, was Valentina Shevchenko. I think if anybody is going to challenge Holm at this point, it's going to be Shevchenko. However, that fight probably will not be made until Valentina at least defends her 125 belt a few more times, turns herself into a star, and then Dana will make that fight, assuming things run their course. I can definitely see them running that back for a super fight, and I think a deservedly so super fight, because both of these women are cleaning out their divisions, and I think the only fights for them to make might be 125 versus 135 at 135, presumably. But anyways, though, hats off to Amanda Nunes, the lady goat, the male goat, both of them getting done here tonight, and I was more than happy to make that call. Okay, in a holy hell, how the hell did that happen? 5 second fastest UFC knockout of all time. George Masvidal flying knees, Ben Askren. So we can kind of walk through this one. Obviously, they have their walkouts. Masvidal comes out to the theme song from Scarface, and so he is ready to definitely gangster it up. Funky Ben Askren comes out to play that funky music or whatever version of dorky, corny crap he has, and he's hanging there. George looks at him across the octagon, leans on the cage, puts him on his back, you know, plays it off, and, you know, Askren goes, hey, I'm going to impose my will on you, I'm going to take you down, walks forward a few steps, Masvidal sprints out of the corner, and with a flying knee, goes right into Askren, trying to sink in a double leg to open up the fight, and it's all she wrote. Askren goes down, stiff as a board, curls toes, curl in, and that is all she wrote. Masvidal throws a two-piece and a biscuit on top of him to kind of round things out before the ref can pull him off, and then he goes through a celebratory routine, does his own stiff, rendition of Askren's KO, and, hey, Masvidal's a bad man. Get that man a title shot. I think that's all we can really agree on right now. Granted, we got this Covington RDA thing, but I think those guys got to take a back seat. You know, if Usman is healthy, it's got to be Masvidal. He's doing it in dramatic fashion. First Till, now Askren. I think it's the time. I think for his popularity, I think for his finish rate right now, how he's doing it, I think it's time to give him Usman, give him that shot at the belt. However, if Usman isn't healthy and, you know, the timing just isn't going to work, I can definitely see an interim title fight going back for welterweight to line up the next competitor for Usman, depending on the winner of this RDA and Covington thing, which would be funny for Covington because he would potentially be fighting for his second interim belt if that were the case. But yeah, Masvidal is just a bad man. He KTFO'd Askren, and that's all we can really say about it. Again, performance of the night money. Hats off to Masvidal. You are a real gangster. All right, our first L on the night here. We had Jan Blaskowicz defeating Luke Rockhold, and this was kind of an interesting fight. So I thought Luke looked okay. He was throwing a lot of kicks, a lot of highlight reel style kicks, and he wasn't really using his hands much. I thought he was basically fighting like almost like a Taekwondo, very kick-heavy kickboxing match, and I just didn't really like that, you know, out of Rockhold. I would have liked to have seen him maybe impose a little more grappling. He did try it a little bit, but he didn't really, go for that deep clinch game and try to get it to the mat, so I think that's kind of where he kind of undid himself. He was outstruck 2-1 against Blaskowicz, and going deep into that first round, we see that clearly Rockhold gets connected on as the bell rings, and it wasn't a late shot. It was at the bell, but still, late in that round, Rockhold was, not unconscious, but he was concussed at that point for sure. Then we get him with that left hook in the second round, and that's all she wrote. He's out before he hits the mat, hits the deck, and Blaskowicz picks up a W here. Great performance by Blaskowicz. I wasn't able to make this call, but it is tough when guys change weight classes. You know, Rockhold was a real stud at 185 up until, you know, his last couple outings, and coming up to 205 maybe just wasn't for him. He also had that staph infection on his foot or his leg. I don't know if that played a factor with him at all. The guy has had historical staph infections, so he's had just kind of a rough go recently, and even Dana himself said it might be time for him to hang it up. He also alluded to Holm as well. It might be time for her to hang it up because, you know, as you keep losing and your former champion, you know, it becomes harder and harder to book you at that rate that you were demanding previously. And if you're not winning and you're at their ages, it is tough. It might be time to walk away. So I'm not saying I want either one of those guys to walk away. That is a personal decision that they must make. But it might be time to consider it. So Blaskowicz picks up the W here, and we pick up an L. Moving on to our next fight, we have Michael Chiesa defeating Diego Sanchez in what was a wrecking machine of a match. So Michael Chiesa has most amazing wrestling and BJJ transitions in the game at 170, at least against Diego. Diego looked like he had no idea what he's doing. I mean, it looked like a blue belt versus a black belt. There was nothing here for Sanchez to offer to Chiesa, and Chiesa just dominated. He I mean, I don't think this fight really stayed standing much at all. There was 47 strikes to 7 strikes for Sanchez, but those 7 strikes were probably on the feet. So I'm going to assume this thing was on the feet for all of maybe a minute, 45 seconds, over 15 minutes. And Chiesa just dictated exactly where this fight was to take place. He had 5 takedowns, and he held them down the entire time. Sanchez is tough as hell, but his grappling skills are not there. Chiesa at 170 was so big, so strong, so technical that Sanchez really had nothing to offer back. And I thought Chiesa was going to get the finish here. He did have it close a few times. However, great defending, great toughness out of Sanchez kind of prevented that. But either way, great victory for Chiesa. It makes a statement at 170, and I would like to see this guy start climbing those ranks. All right, in a fight that we were not able to call correctly, Arnold Allen defeats Gilbert Melendez, and I really personally didn't think Melendez was going to win this one. I know the numbers kind of said it, but it's one of those cases, you know, you got a guy that was a former champion, so his numbers, you know, historically were edged up so high against kind of a up-and-comer, you know, it doesn't have as many stats, and it just kind of creates a lopsided affair. Also, Melendez hasn't won a fight in those, like, last 5 outings, so I personally didn't like it. I know I made the pick, and hey, you know, anything could have happened, but I didn't personally like it. And if that's information you guys really want for me to say about, you know, on the fight pick analysis show, let me know. I can kind of give ones I like or don't like overall. But anyways, Melendez just kind of tried to hang a pocket. He wasn't really moving much. I think he was just loading up for one big shot, and that was his only pathway to victory. I think he was, you know, believing in himself, whereas Arnold Allen threw amazing combinations. He pieced up Melendez. He made Melendez look like the old man that he is, a guy that should probably retire, and Arnold Allen made a statement for himself in this preliminary main event. So hats off to Arnold Allen. I'm looking forward to calling your fights more, and I hope you can pick up a KO in your next one. All right, in our next fight, this was an L as well, but this one was close as hell. It was Marlon Vera and Nolan Hernandez, and Vera was, you know, getting the better of Hernandez very early on. However, Hernandez turned the tide in the second round. He goes for a poorly timed takedown, catches a knee, goes down. Vera takes his back, and that's all she wrote, but he had this fight going in his direction. He outstruck Vera 22-10. They both had takedowns. They were looking very competitive, especially for a short notice replacement for sure. Sean O'Malley, I thought Hernandez looked amazing, but that one small mistake, and that's this game. You know, you can be winning a fight and somebody hits a 50-point shot at the buzzer, and all of a sudden your 10-20-point lead is nothing. And this guy got shut down in the second. Hats off to Vera, though. He stayed tough. He was able to fight back in a fight that he was winning early on, let it slip, and was still able to close the door. Great fight IQ, great timing, amazing win for Vera, but an L for us. In our next matchup, lady strawweight matchup, we had Claudia Gadelha defeat Ronda Marcos in what was a, you know, kind of okay fight. There were no takedowns from Gadelha, which I was a little surprised by, but Marcos just refused to engage. You know, she just wouldn't really fight inside the pocket. Claudia almost outstrikes her 2-1, and she does just enough, plenty, doesn't really take any real chances, but Marcos wasn't really giving her any. You know, I don't know if Marcos wanted to have, like, you know, crazy inside match. Maybe she only worked grappling and takedown defense, so Gadelha not throwing any real takedowns in there, just some level changes kind of screwed Marcos up with her own rhythm and everything she trained. I'm not sure what the case was, but it didn't really look like she wanted to be in there. Maybe something was going on outside of the cage or an injury, but either way, Gadelha got this one done. We called it correctly, and that's all I ultimately really care about. In our next matchup, another amazing one, performance of the night. Song Yadong defeats Alejandro Perez. I said that it was going to go down this way. Yadong looked amazing, threw an amazing right cross to get the knockout. This is another KTFO situation against Perez. Yadong, super efficient, very technical. Over at Alpha Male, or Team Alpha as they call it now, they say this guy is even better grappling than he has striking, and I would love to see this on display. The bantamweight division is on fire right now, and Yadong just elevates it to another level. I want to see this guy fight again. He made Perez look bad, and I think that he can do it again. This guy is on a rocket ship, and I think he could be a future star in the UFC. Speaking of future stars, another amazing one. 1 minute, 12 seconds in, Edmund Shahbazyan defeats Jack Marshman. So Shahbazyan goes for, like, you know, regular old takedown, and then he just starts ground and pounding Jack Marshman. I mean, normally you see guys kind of get into a situation where they want to go on the guard, play some jiu-jitsu. No, not Shahbazyan. He's just throwing bombs as quickly as possible as soon as Marshman's on the ground. And I don't think Marshman really expected that level of violence and intensity to come so early. You know, Marshman didn't throw a single punch in this fight. If you look at his stats, it's zeros across. Shahbazyan, 13 strikes, one takedown, one sub, two passes. Marshman just nil, nothing. And Shahbazyan proved that he is an amazing middleweight fighter. He's climbing the ladder. The kid's looking phenomenal. He's an amazing prospect. And I got to see what this kid can do because he looked so aggressive. He had that super high fight IQ. He closed the door as early as possible. And that's what you really want in a fighter. You don't want somebody who, you know, necessarily sees the red mist and gets caught in an armbar or something. But, you know, time can, you know, fix those, you know, errors, clear the legs, and then drop some GMP and get it done. Either way, though, kind of rambling. Shahbazyan nailed it, picked this up the W, and I'm happy to call it. In our next match, one that was very frustrating for me, so I had called Ishmael Nurdiev as being the winner of this one. He picked up an L against Chance Rencounter. Rencounter's wrestling was just way too good. He held down Nurdiev at every exchange. Nurdiev is supposedly an Austrian wrestling champion, but he did not look it that night. I'm not sure what happened. He was content to kind of hang on his back, couldn't really get to the fence, couldn't get up, couldn't do much of anything. He outstruck Rencounter 21-4, but I mean, this fight was primarily on the ground. Rencounter did just enough to hold him down. Not an exciting way to win, but definitely a way to pick up a W. And a little, you know, kind of frustrating because I think had this fight been able to stand its feet longer, we would have had Rencounter, you know, take a little more damage and maybe, you know, prevent this from being an L for us. Either way, though, we did pick up an L, and that's just the way it plays out. Finally, in our last performance, we had Julia Avila defeat Penny Kinzad in what was a very good fight, especially to open this thing up. Avila just had a much better kickboxing game. We saw Kinzad get the takedown and not really do anything with it, and ultimately, Avila was able to pick up the unanimous decision to open things up and start the night off with a W for us. So, with that being said, we went 8-4 on the night. Very good numbers. I'm always aiming for those, getting close to that 70%. Anything around 2/3 is really solid, and I am very, very happy to make that call. This now brings us on to housekeeping. Please get in touch with the Fighting Spirit Podcast at fightingspiritpodcast@gmail.com. You also can find us on Facebook. I'm on Twitter. My handle is at MMAFightPicks01. Please get in touch with us there. We're also posting on Instagram, and you can find us on YouTube as well. Please like and subscribe to our page, or like the videos and subscribe to the page. And I think that about does it for this show. So I have a few fights to crunch for our next event. So next week we have, you know, not the, it's kind of a down slope up until, you know, we get to maybe something a little bit better. But we got Duraname versus Ladd in Sacramento, California. Not the worst, you know, card. I'm not exceptionally excited about the main event, but you know, we get Uriah Faber coming back there, Josh Emmett's fighting again, Benil Dariush, a couple of decent ones in there, Andre Philly against Shaman Moraes, very good one, Nico Montagna's coming back, Darren Elkins is fighting again, he's fighting Ryan Hall, so maybe a heel hook will be in order there, a couple of good ones, a couple of ones I'm looking forward to, but maybe not the most exciting event overall, but it's tough to compete with these International Fight Week cards. They're always going to seem a little bit hollow compared to, you know, what we just saw, but hey, outcomes cannot be predetermined by the card, so who knows what will happen. Either way, I'll be crunching that. So with that being said, I'll be back on Tuesday. Thank you for listening, and until I speak with you again, happy fight picking.